Hi everyone! This is the first video in a short series of videos in which I'll be covering the basics of calculus. If you follow along with me, you'll learn how to find the rate of change of a function at a point, as well as the area between the graph of a function and the x-axis. These are the two fundamental problems to which calculus provides an answer, and everything we learn will be based on these two concepts. Today we're going to learn about functions, which, at least for now, are really the only kinds of equations we're interested in. In algebra, we wrote equations as y equals and then something involving x. If an equation is a function, we can replace the y with f of x. When we used to write coordinate points as x, y, we can now write them as x, f of x. A function is a special kind of equation that tells us about the unique relationship between two variables, x and y. The reason functions are so special and interesting to us is because a function will give you one and only one y for any x you put into it. You put one value in, you get one value out. Oftentimes we like to think about a function machine that has an input side and an output side. The machine itself is the equation that relates x and y. When you put an x value into the input side of the machine, it will calculate exactly one y value and spit it out on the output side of the machine. Because of this kind of one-to-one relationship between inputs and outputs, you can think of a function as being made up of its entire set of input-output pairs. Each pair is one point on the graph of the function. The graph, therefore, is a picture of all the input-output pairs, and it can help us predict and visualize the output that the function will return for any input. Now, if you're taking calculus, it probably means that you've taken lots of other math classes to get to this point, and that you've probably talked about domain and range somewhere along the way. The concepts of domain and range are very closely associated with the concept of a function and the one-to-one input-output relationship that it models. You can think of the domain of a function as the set of all possible input values. Depending on the function, some values will be impossible to input. For example, you'll remember from previous math courses that, at least with real numbers, you can't take the square root of a negative number. So if you have a square root sign in your function, you won't be able to input any value into your function machine that will make the value underneath your square root sign negative. These inputs just won't work. You can't put them into your function, so they're not in the domain of your function. The range of a function is completely dependent on the domain, because the range is made up of all of the values that you can get out of your function machine as a result of inputting all the values in the domain. For example, if your function is x squared, you can input any value you want without breaking the laws of mathematics or your function machine, so the domain is the set of all real numbers. The range of the function, however, is only positive real numbers. Regardless of whether you input negative or positive values into the function, because you're squaring each value, you can only get positive numbers out of it, and so the range of the function is only positive real numbers. Functions are not any equation that can return multiple output values for a single input value. Circles are a great example of non-functions. If we pick any x value inside the circle, we can see that the equation of the circle will return two output values for the single input value. Remember, by definition, an equation can only be a function if it returns exactly one output for every input value. So we can clearly see that a circle will never be a function. This brings us to a great way to test for functions. It's called the vertical line test, and it says that if you draw a perfectly vertical line anywhere in the domain of a function, it will cross the graph only once. If you can draw a perfectly vertical line that crosses the graph more than once, then the points at which the line intersects the graph represent multiple output values for the single input value, and therefore, the graph cannot represent a function. Keep in mind also that a function can itself be comprised of multiple functions. This polynomial function is a great example. The entire thing represents a function, but so do each of the four terms inside it. If taken separately, each one would pass the vertical line test. This function is therefore what we call a combination of other functions. Functions can also be compositions of other functions, where one function is nested inside another. For example, e to the x is a function, and x squared is a function. E to the x squared is a composition of functions where x squared is nested inside e to the x. Sine of x squared plus 1 is another good example of a composition of functions. Next time, we're going to dive into the real foundations of calculus and start talking about limits and continuity. I'll see you then. Click on a video for a more in-depth look at the topics covered. Review this video by clicking the links on the right, and subscribe to be notified of future videos.